morning.
Good morning.
How is everybody doing today?
Feeling like crap.
There was a lot of answers. All I heard was good, great. I heard, blah, 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 and then I heard like crap. So it's a wide variety, right? There's a wide array of answers to that. Well, I'm excited this morning for a couple reasons. One is because it's not snowing. Finally. The second reason I'm really excited is because I get to share with you this morning God's word. So I'm really excited about that. So this morning, I want to talk to you, share with you for the next half hour, just some thoughts. And yes, I have a trash can with me this morning for a reason. No, it's not because I carry one around with me. No, I don't live in one. I'm not Oscar the Grouch, okay? So, though sometimes I feel like I'm Oscar the Grouch, but I don't live in a trash can. Now, I want to share with you this morning about garbage, about trash, about recycling, about dumpster diving, those types of things. And I know what you're thinking, that doesn't seem like a real churchy kind of a message. It's not. But I want us to think about some things this morning. I want us to go through some things. A few statistics for you. We have a trash problem in the United States. We have a trash problem really all over the world, but I happen to live in the United States, so I'm gonna, and you do as well, so we're gonna discuss the United States. Did you know that the average person produces about 4.6 pounds of trash a day? Each person, 4.6 pounds of trash, you're thinking, oh, that's not that big of a deal. But if you were to take that and multiply it over a year, and then you were to get a football field, including the end zones, right? The football field is 100 yards plus 10 on each side for the end zones. If you were to take that 120-yard field, I think by 35 yards, and you were to dig a hole straight down, we produce enough trash in a year to fill that football-size hole 100 miles deep. That's a lot of trash, right? I mean, that is a lot of trash, right? In fact, we create almost 2 pounds more of trash each day than we did in 1960. In fact, I actually produce about 4.6 pounds more trash than I did in 1960 because I didn't exist in 1960. But for those of you who were alive in 1960, some of you were like, 1960, I was graduating from college. That's fine, you know, riding pterodactyls or whatever. That's good. No. I'm just kidding. I'm just joking, right? Calm down. I realized the other day I feel like I'm getting old. But anyway, we produce all of this stuff, right? Do you know, how many of you ever use like plastic wrap, saran wrap, whatever you want to call it? Yeah. Do you know in the United States we use enough, as a nation, we use enough saran wrap a year that we could saran wrap the state of Texas? Everything's bigger in Texas. Right? We have enough saran wrap to cover this, to wrap up the state of Texas and put it in like a doggy bag and take it home with us. Right? I mean, that much of just one thing. And now, I don't want to, you know, I didn't come here to give like, you know, an environmental sermon or anything like that, but I want us to consider that. And why do we produce so much trash? Why do we produce more trash now than we did in 1960? Than we did just a decade ago or two decades ago. In fact, we're actually increasing the amount of trash that we produce is increasing faster than the population is increasing. So we're using more, we're producing more trash. Why is that? It's because we live in a disposable society. Everything is disposable. Everything. Like, we don't use things over and over again anymore. We produce things to throw them away, right? Because it's more convenient. Just the other day, I was in Hannaford, and I was looking at, you know, ribs and things like that, and I'm looking forward to when it's a little bit warmer weather so I can make my own ribs. But they have these pre-cooked, packaged ribs that you can buy that you can just heat and serve. And one of the brands comes in a convenient, oven-ready container to be cooked in. It's like a metal. It's cheap metal. But it comes in a convenient thing. But it says, do not reuse the container. So there's this metal thing you cook the ribs in for 15 minutes to heat them back up. And then you take this container and you throw it away. We live in a society where everything is disposable, right? So think about it. I mean, things that used to be reusable, things that we would like use over and over again, things that were built to last. Here I am sounding like a, you know, old man, get off my lawn, right? But we used to back in the day, you know, back in whatever, you know, we used to produce things that would last, like things like cars, right? They were made not to have to buy them every couple years, right? I mean, it wasn't uncommon for people to be like, I've got 200 and something thousand miles on my, now it's like, you know, 100,000 miles and they're like, that thing's probably gonna blow up, right? Anybody here ever bought a new car that had a warranty, whatever it is, 5 years, whatever, and then like a day, a week, maybe a month after the warranty ran out, it broke? Anybody ever had that problem? Yeah, right? We do. But you know why? Because they're made to do that. There's a reason why they say 5 years, however many miles, because they know that they really don't want to guarantee it beyond that because it's just not going to work. Back in the day, back when I was a kid, how many of you remember when we had soda bottles that were reusable, right? Glass containers. This, I guarantee you did not grow up drinking. It's called Chinoto, and it's an amazing soda. Amazing. Like, I love it. It's this great thing. But Chinoto is very popular in Venezuela, or used to be really popular in Venezuela. Venezuela doesn't really have anything currently because of the economic troubles, but you might not be able to see it, but on this bottle, on the parts that stick out the most, the rounded edges here, they're all scraped up all the way around the bottle. And the reason that they're scraped up all the way around the bottle, for those of you who didn't grow up drinking out of glass bottles, is because once you would take this wonderful bottle and you would drink it, you would then turn it back in. They would take said glass bottle, they'd put it in a little package thing, it would go back to the bottler where they would clean it, hopefully, and then refill it. And then someone else would get the same bottle and enjoy the wonderful Chinoto that was in the bottle. And then they too would give it back in and it would be cleaned, hopefully, and over and over and over again. Now, in Venezuela and parts of South America and other parts of the world, they still do that. You buy glass bottles, you pop the top off it, you drink your soda or your water, whatever, and then you give it back in so that they can reuse it, right? Now, Maine is one of the few states, actually one of, I think, just two or three, depending on what it is, Hawaii is another one, where we have what's called bottle deposit. Some of you who aren't from Maine have gone to buy a soda or whatever, and they ring it in, you know, like the little thing says, it's 89 cents, and then they ring it in, and it's like 89 cents, and you see this little plus 5 cents deposit. The reason Maine does that, well, I'm not going to say that, because really the reason is just to get more money. But anyway, the theory behind it is this, that you would spend that 5 cents deposit, you would then turn in your bottle, and you would get 5 cents back so that it could be recycled. Most things don't recycle. Craziest thing, in Texas, we were in Texas recently, and they had original Dr. Pepper, because Dr. Pepper was invented in Texas, Waco, Texas, which thank you, Waco, Texas. I love Dr. Pepper. But anyway, they have original in glass bottles that you can buy. And I bought it. I was like, oh, this is, because it's made with the original thing. It's not like that high fructose corn syrup stuff. No. It's like original. It's so good. It doesn't leave that slimy thing in the back of your mouth. But All right, I got it, I drank it, I was like, oh, this is so good. And then I said to the lady, I said, do you want the glass bottle back? She's like, no. I'm like, what do you do with them? She goes, we put them in the trash. You put glass bottles back in the trash? Yeah, what else would we do with them? I don't know, recycle them? She's like, no, we don't do that here in Texas. It's like, that's why there's enough saran wrap to wrap up your state. But anyway, most states, they don't recycle. I mean, it's crazy. For growing up here in Maine and growing up in that culture of reusing things, like, it was just, it would make sense. Like, you know, to this day, when I go to restaurants in other parts of the country, I get a soda or whatever. I don't throw the container away. I put it on the, where I, you know, like, dump my trash. I put it up on there. I know that they come and take it and throw it away, but I'm not going to do it, right? Because it's this mindset of disposable, right? So we've gone from the glass containers that we would reuse and re-drink to our plastic bottles. More Chinoto. So good. I got this in Venezuela. I brought both of these back. This one I've actually brought back full and then drank it quickly afterwards. But so we've gone from this to this. Now, here the interesting thing is, I don't read Spanish very well. I only read English a little bit better than Spanish. But I do know that there is no refund, there is no deposit on these bottles. They, like us, take these things and they just throw them away. Right? They just throw them away. Now, I know, we recycle. We don't. Recycling actually isn't really working because most people just don't recycle. They just throw it away, right? So the theory behind it is that we would reuse all of these things, but we don't reuse these in their original state. No, we melt them down. We destroy them and rebuild. In fact, we've gone so far, have you seen the warnings, like, do not reuse your, like, water bottle? Like, regular water bottle, because, like, if you do, if it's been in a car for 5 minutes and you reuse it, like, some gremlin's gonna, like, eat your brain or something. I mean, it's really bad, right? I mean, it's terrible. Like, this thing they warn you with, and you're like, but I just had it this morning, and I just put more water in it. Don't do that. Apparently, you're gonna die. It's one of those things that will kill you. But we don't. We live in a society where we just take everything, and we just toss it in the trash. Things that were meant to last are now disposable. And this isn't, again, this isn't just about the environment or these, but we do it spiritually as well. Things that used to matter, things that were built to last, things that God gave to us to run the long term, to constantly have with us, to not just throw away, we take and we throw them away. It's all disposable now. I mean, think about the things that we just toss away. Right? I mean, we used to have morals, right? And those used to be something that we would stand on, like, no, we have morality. And now it's like, morality? What are you talking about? There's no absolute morals. It's whatever we want to do. So we take morals and we're like, I don't need your morals anymore. Just toss those away. Don't need them. Right? Not a lot. We don't live by them anymore. We don't use those things long term. We just get rid of it. Right? How about church? That's a good one. There used to be a day and age where church was what everybody did. Right? We went to church. I mean, I didn't grow up in a Christian home, but even I went to church sometimes. I'd go with my friends. I had friends that, like, that was what they did on Sunday mornings. Like, you went to church. Now Sunday is like, oh, man, I don't want to go to church. I got other things to do, right? We take church and we just go from here to here to here, and we hop around all these different churches because we're just like, it's just a consumable item. It's disposable. I don't need it in my life. I can use it when I want to. I can come and, like, okay, I have my church service. I'm good, you know, until Easter or Christmas, and then we just toss it away. We take all of these things, like the church, and we do these things, and we just throw them away. 1 Timothy 3, verses 14 through 15 says this. It says, I hope to come to you soon. But I am writing these things to you so that if I delay, you may know how one ought to behave in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, a pillar and buttress of the truth. A pillar. Something that stood as a over time for us to notice, the pillar of truth. He's like, I want you to know how to behave in the house of God. Right? Not all these don't do this, don't do that, don't do this. But like, truth. Truth is another one of those things. Right? There was a time when truth was absolute. Do you know most people, including Christians, don't believe that there is an absolute truth? That everything depends on the situation. Right? Just depends on the situation. And we're all like, well, yeah, that makes sense. Right? You know, this old stingy stuff where everything is, you know, cut and dry, black and white. No, there's so much gray area now. But there's always something in our life. There's always some point at which we leave that gray area, and even we are like, no, that's we got to hold on to that one. Right? There are certain things we're like, oh, well, you know, lying. Well, everybody does it. Well, yeah, it doesn't make it right. You know, there's this new thing where it's like, if we do something wrong, we just have to find someone else who's done it and say, well, they did it too. Okay, so they were wrong too. No. Right? But then you like say things like, hacking up a person with an axe. Most of us would be like, whoa, no, that's a line too far. That's not just hack up people with axes. Well, if there's no standard, then we could do whatever we want to do. If something isn't precious, we can do anything we want. Hebrews 10:25 says, do not neglect to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encourage one another. And all the more when you see the day drawing near. The day they're talking about there is the end, right? The day of Christ's return, when things get really crazy in those days, where truth is looked at as a lie, lie is looked at as truth, good is evil, evil is good, and everything's just kind of swapped around. Everything becomes disposable. So we take these things and we just throw them out. Right? I remember a day when marriage was something that was supposed to last. Right? I mean, it was just like, till death do us part. And no, I don't mean hack them up with an axe to end it, Yeah, absolutely, till death do us part. That's why I'm going to kill them. No, I don't mean that. Right? But we get this way. One of the first questions I ask any couple that's thinking about getting married and they want me to do the wedding, and I just sit down and do some counseling. One of the first questions I ask them is, under what circumstances would you consider ending the marriage? And I have some people who are like, what do I give the answer to a pastor? Do I lie to him? I don't want to lie to him because like I'm sitting in the church office, Some people say, never. Okay. I've heard everything, though. I heard someone say, until I get bored. Thank you for your honesty. That's a disposable marriage. I've heard, everything from boredom to, I won't go to that one. We're in mixed company, and I don't want to. But I've heard some pretty crazy things as to why people would end their marriage. And it's not things like, I've heard them, but it's not things like, abuse or adultery. I mean, it's like, seriously, like, if they put things in the refrigerator wrong, like, this is not good. That makes your marriage disposable. I'm not in the business of disposable marriages, right? Marriages are supposed to last. They're things from God, right? That we're supposed to do these things. So many things that God created, we have made disposable. They don't last anymore. We don't reuse them. We don't continue with them for life. We just toss them by the side. Now, some of this is because of our disposable mindset, right? Where we just want more convenient and easier and no challenge, right? Sometimes it's like the first sign of trouble in whatever, in marriages or in church or in our prayer life or any of these things that God gives us. The first time there's any sort of struggle, we're just like, toss it out, get a new one. But some of this disposable mindset comes from the spiritual side of it, where we don't hold true to the things of God. We don't hold true to those things that are important. We kind of throw everything in a dumpster. And it's in the dumpster and it's gone and we don't need it and we move on. You know, I remember a time, and I don't remember where I was going, but I was on a bus and we were in a city and we were stuck at construction. And I remember it was kind of like an overpass, and I was looking down and I could see the city down below. And I remember seeing this, like, it was behind a store, and it was there was this dumpster there. And the dumpster was pretty full, and there was trash overflowing around the dumpster. And I remember just looking out and I was watching, and I see this man come up who I assume was homeless. He was dirty, and his clothes were all stained, and he was unkempt. And I remember him going up to this dumpster. I mean, this was a big dumpster. And he pushed open the top of the dumpster, and all of a sudden he starts looking in the dumpster. And he's digging through it, and I'm watching, and he would pull things out, and he would, like, shake his head, and he would toss it over to the side. And then he would dig in, and I remember seeing him take some things that looked like food containers, and he had a backpack, and he would, you know, like, kind of smile and put those things in his backpack. And I remember as he was digging through this, I'm thinking to myself, wow, this is crazy. I mean, I'm from, you know, Union, Maine, and we barely have dumpsters in Union, Maine, much less, you know, this thought. I had never seen this before. And I remember him reaching in, and he pulls out this rag, and he holds up the rag to his chest, and I see that it's a shirt. I mean, just because of its shape, not because... And he pulls up, and he looks at it, and he gets this big grin on his face, and he neatly folds it up and puts it into his backpack. And then he, like, smiles, and he walks off, like, excited about his discovery. And I just remember thinking, wow. I mean, we've all done that. We've all gone to stores and been like, you know, looking in the mirror and like, oh yeah, this will fit. Or, you know, like, does this make my butt look fat? Or, right? Don't ever ask anybody that question, right? Because you put them in a no-win situation at that point. But we've all done that. I think, man, I've done that, but I've done it in a store. And here is this man having to dig through the garbage. And he finds this thing, and to him, it's like, this is valuable. This is a treasure. And he walks away, like, proud of his efforts. And I was just, like, stunned. And I'm thinking, like, wow, you know, what a shame. You know, that poor guy. Like, wow, what is life like that? And, you know, and I don't always think about this, but I remember, I mean, just like recently, this has come up into my mind. I just started thinking about it again, and this is kind of where that message came from. And the more I think about that guy going through the trash and how bad I felt for him, you know, I just want to say to you this morning, I think he was doing the job that Jesus does. And I know it sounds crazy, like, you know, our Lord and Savior. And we always think of Jesus, and we think of, like, you know, the white gowns, and, you know, like, really kept and wonderful. And we think of him, like, the flowing model hair, you know, like, where everywhere he walks, like, there's the fan blowing, just the right enough breeze where Jesus has this hair, you know. Some churches, he's blonde hair, blue eyes, you know, which would be really different for a Jew in that time. But anyway, right, whatever makes us happy. But, you know, we think of Jesus that way, but the reality of it is Jesus is a dumpster diver. And I don't mean that in a way to, like, you know, disparage our God. And I don't mean that like he's poor or anything. No, no, no. But what he does is he gets into the world, which is a dumpster, by the way. There's so much filth and garbage in our world. And I don't mean just literal garbage, but I mean spiritual garbage. There's so much of it in the world today. And what does Jesus do? Jesus goes digging through. He digs through our lives, and he's like, okay, nope. Mike, man, what are you doing with this, man? Mike, that's trash. And he throws that trash over the side. But then he finds things in our life, and he's like, it's dirty, but I can reuse that in your life. I can clean that off. I can restore that in your life. And Jesus dives in the dumpster and he does those things. And he finds things in our life that are worth keeping. And he finds things in our life that we have thrown away, that we've discarded, that we've said, no, that's gone, that's trash, it's garbage. But God says, no, 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 no. You're throwing it away, but I can reuse it. You thought it was disposable, but it's not disposable. I want you to reuse that in your life. I want you to keep doing those things. I want you to go back to that. Right? I want you to go back to your prayer life. Oh man, that thing, yeah, that's been in there for a while, hasn't it? Oh man, that smells bad. Your prayer life stinks, right? And he'll clean it off. I said, no, I want you to go back to your prayer life. No, those relationships you've just thrown away, there's value in those things. And he takes those things that are of value and he cleans them off and he cleans them up in our life. But you know what? He does more than that. Because sometimes I found in my life when I've, in a place where of, really a lot of times of my own doing, bad decisions, poor choices, sin in my life, times when I felt like I'm in the dumpster myself, like my life is in the dumps. I don't want you to raise your hand, but maybe you've never been to that place where you feel like your life's in a dumpster and it's just trash and there's no hope in it. But I've been there. I've been in those things. You know, I struggle with anxiety and depression. Have for most of my adult life. I mean, I think I did when I was a kid too, but I just didn't realize it. And I have times, whether it's through the things that I've done to put me there or just my feelings of depression or whatever, and or things that are happening around me, I feel like I'm in the trash can. And I feel like I'm Oscar and I'm a grouch, but I'm not happy about it. And I'm not on TVs like, you know, giving good morals. I'm in the dumpster in my life and I'm not giving any good advice. I'm just ready to sit there and rot in this dumpster with no hope in my life. But Jesus comes along when we're in that dumpster, when our lives feel like that. And maybe you're there this morning, or maybe sometime in the near future you're going to be there. And you're going to think to yourself those thoughts of, can I be redeemed? Am I disposable? Is there any value left in my life? Do I have anything else to offer to anyone or any person? Or do I have anything to give to this world? Do I have anything left? Or am I just trash? And you ask yourselves those questions. Can I be redeemed? Is there any hope for me? And I know it sounds crazy, but God looks for us in those things. And you see, he sees someone, a life that's salvageable. He's looking through the dumpster of this world and he's pulling you out. And you feel like you're worthless and you're trash and you have no hope and you've been disposed of. But God says, no, 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 no. He holds you up and he's like, yeah, I can use this. I can redeem this. Because you see, God looks at it and he can hold his nose, right? I mean, he can hold his nose to the things that are happening, the life that's around him. He can hold his nose and he doesn't get, you know, nauseous. I know sometimes when I'm doing trash stuff, you know, that was always my chore growing up, as I took out the trash. There were times where it was just like, you know, you're swallowing it back. Anyway, but he can hold his nose and he can pull it out from the dirtiest, smelliest, stinkiest thing. And he can salvage it. He's looking for something to salvage. Salvage means this: to prevent destruction, to rescue something and put it to good use, to return something to its true purpose. God wants to take you out of that dumpster and he wants to return you to good working condition. He wants to rescue you from destruction. He wants to take you out of that trash. He wants to take you out of that mire. He wants to take you out of it, and he wants to put you in a higher place, a pinnacle. He wants to take you out of the dumpster, clean you off, and then put you up and say, look, look what I found. Look at the treasure that I found. And we can feel like trash. He's like, no, 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 no. You're not trash. You're my choice possession. You're the thing that I like rejoice that I found. David, King David in the Bible, in Psalm 51, in Psalm 51, David's at this point in his life What David has done is, at this point, is, if you don't know the story of David, he was the king, and one day he was out on his balcony, and he happened to be looking, and he saw this beautiful woman and taking a bath, and he didn't stop looking. He continued to look, and not only did he continue to look, he's like, you know what? I want her. And so he took her, and they laid together in a biblical sense. I don't want to get too graphic for you, but so he had an affair with this. She was a married woman. And so when he did this, he was like, you know, that's not so good. And instantly when he gone through this, her husband became disposable to him, the king, and he was a military soldier. And he sent him into battle and told some of his other soldiers, hey, once you get into battle and you start fighting, I want you guys to kind of withdraw, let him stay out there and get killed. Problem solved. But problem wasn't solved because God wasn't all about that. In fact, Nathan, who was a prophet, a man of God, who God was sent into places to give truth and things like that, to encourage people, to let them know when they were doing something wrong, God sent Nathan there to him and said to him, hey, David, you know, you can't be doing this. I know what you've done. Right? I mean, I know the sins you've committed, and God's not going to be okay with that. And David felt kind of like garbage, and he went to God, and he was like, in verse 2 of Psalm 51, he says, wash away my guilt and cleanse me from my sin, for I am conscious of my rebellion, in verse 3, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you alone I have sinned and done this evil in your sight, so you are right. When you pass sentence, you are blameless when you judge. Indeed, I was guilty when I was born. I was sinful when my mother conceived me. Surely you desire integrity in the inner self, and you teach me wisdom deep within. Purify me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Think about that. Verse 10, God, create a clean heart for me and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore the joy of your salvation to me and give me a willing spirit. Then I will teach the rebellious your ways, and sinners will return to you. David said, God, I'm in the dumpster. And it's my own reason, and I did it, and I'm guilty of it, but I don't want to be in the dumpster. So he was pleading with God, and he knew that God would come and take him out of that and would clean him off. And he said that you would make me white as snow. He wanted us to be clean. That's what Jesus did for all of us. He came into the dumpster of this world. He went dumpster diving for people who were far from him, people who were dirty and filthy from all of their own decisions, from the things of the world. And he walked around and he went in and he pulls us out and he cleans us off because he died for you and for me. He went dumpster diving and he became nothing so that we could be something because he loved us so much, not because he wants to hold us against us, but because he wants us to be clean. And he did all of the work. He said, I want to salvage, I want to restore you to your original purpose. You see, we weren't created to be trash. We were created as a masterpiece. We were created to be something amazing. He says, you're not trash. You're valuable. Do you need salvaging this morning? Are you looking for someone to reclaim you? Are you looking to have restoration, maybe to be put back into useful condition? Are you looking for your true purpose in life? Because you're like, man, this can't be what life is all about. Can you be recycled, redeemed? And I don't mean for 5 cents. I mean for eternity. That's what Jesus does. The great dumpster diver came to retrieve us from the garbage, to take us from the pit, which is with like the 100-mile pit where we just burn things and destroy. He wants to take us out of the pit and put us at the pinnacle because he wants us to have a relationship with him. God's in the restoration business. Jesus is dumpster diving and he's looking for you. And he wants to take you and take all of that garbage that's in your life, throw the garbage aside, clean up the things that are salvageable. And he says, I want to present to you the new you. I want you to realize you're not garbage. You are a valuable, valuable find for me. And he's going to fold you up nicely and he's going to walk away from the dumpster with you and said, man, I love this thing that I just found. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you this morning. And Lord, some of us here this morning feel like we're in a dumpster. Some of us feel like we're covered in trash and there's things all around us. Some of us feel like, Lord, we're a dumpster and we're just in it and we're trashed and useless. But I pray, Lord, that you spoke to us this morning about our value. I pray that you spoke to each and every person here who feels like they're in a dumpster. Let them know that they're not, that they're valuable to you. You know, if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you don't, maybe you didn't realize that he went dumpster diving for you and that you're valuable to him. Maybe you're living like you feel like you're in trash. And I want you to know this morning that he wants to have a relationship with you. He doesn't want to keep you in the dumpster. He wants to pull you out of it and clean you. And he did all of the work. You don't have to pull yourself out of the dumpster. He wants to pull you out of it. And he says, I want to have a relationship with you. And that's what salvation is. Salvation is a free gift. Jesus did the work. He wants us to take the gift. So if you've never done that this morning, I want you to just pray something like this in your heart. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you. I know that I'm in a dumpster. I know that there are things in my life that are dirty. But thank you for coming and finding me in that dumpster. And right here, right now, this morning, I want to take that free gift of salvation. I want to take that hand up out of the dumpster. I want to be restored. And if you said that prayer this morning, the Bible tells us that when we make that commitment, when we take that free gift, that we are now belong to the Lord. And we are saved. We're saved from hell. We're saved from that pit. And if you just said that prayer this morning for the first time, would you just slip your hand up? I just want to be able to pray and like rejoice if there's anyone this morning. If you've already made that commitment in your life, and maybe you're struggling, maybe you're going through things, or maybe you will in the future, or maybe you just came out of it, but whatever, you feel like you're in the dumpster, I want you to know that you are loved by God. You are his choice possession. You are the find that he's looking for. He is in the dumpster, and he will not stop looking until he finds you. And he'll pull you out. He'll dust you off. He'll wash you. He'll cleanse you. He'll polish you up to continue with him because he loves you that much. God, I thank you. I thank you for all the things you're doing to us. And I just praise you this morning. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen.